You guys are all so quiet. My name's Addie Paschal. Welcome tonight to the talk. I am the wife of Ben Paschal, who's a senior pastor here at the Presbyterian Church. Just want to extend our gratitude to Ben and the church for offering this space for the talk tonight. I'm also an RN, and I have the privilege of working with Dr. Shlim at his travel medicine practice out in Wilson. So I've had a firsthand experience of just getting to know just how vast his depth of knowledge and expertise is on all things travel medicine. So I think we're all in for a real treat tonight, and I'm glad you guys are all here. Just a couple of housekeeping items. If anyone needs their restrooms, they are straight back out the doors and to the hallway to your left, if you need that. And if everyone can just take a minute and silence your cell phones, that'll help with minimized distractions for the talk tonight. Just to share a little bit about Dr. Shlim before we get started, if you're not familiar with him, he ran the world's first and to this day the busiest destination travel medicine clinic in Kathmandu, Nepal for 15 years, from 1983 to 1988. He's authored more than 50 papers on travel-related diseases. He's written more than 24 chapters in medical textbooks. He is an editor for the CDC's Health Information for International Travel. That's one of the main books in the world for health professionals and travel medicine. He discovered a new intestinal pathogen called cyclospora. He is the co-author of a book called Medicine and Compassion. This is the first book to present Tibetan Buddhist insights into training and compassion to a Western professional audience. He also runs the Medicine and Compassion Project, which is an educational effort to promote training and compassion to help medical care workers cultivate compassion that is more stable, vast, and effortless. He was the first American doctor to be invited to join the travel medicine faculty of the Royal Society of Physicians and Surgeons in Glasgow. He was elected the president of the International Society of Travel Medicine. This is a society with over 4,000 members in over 100 countries. He also served on the Teton District Board of Health for 10 years. And if all that isn't impressive enough for you, let me also tell you that he served as the tour doctor for the Rolling Stones for 3 years. Traveling to Canada, the US, Japan, China, and Australia. So I think we can all agree that we're really lucky to have Dr. Shlim here in the Valley living and practicing travel medicine. So anyways, without further ado, I want to introduce Dr. David Shlim.
Nice. Thank you. Nice. Nice invitation. There, okay. Oh, it goes off by itself. Hi. So, thank you. You know, a few weeks ago, I just got this idea that I hadn't given a talk about travel medicine in the community for a long time. I'd done a few in the past at the library and at the hospital, and so it had nothing to do with coronavirus at that time. I just thought it'd be nice to talk about some inside look at, give you a better understanding of how travel medicine works, and I'm still going to do that, but obviously the relationship between travel and coronavirus has really accelerated just in very recently, so I'll try to cover that to an extent as well. But as I was standing here, as people were coming in, and everyone wanted to shake my hand, you know, I think that I think I'd like to see if I can change the tradition in Jackson Hole. I think it's awkward, fist bumps, elbows is kind of awkward, but in where I live for a really long time, people greeted each other like this. And it's very hygienic, and that's why they do it. They're very awkward to shake hands. They don't do it very well. But so I'd love to go around town square and see people going, they say namaste, that's not necessary, but just this is a way to greet people very nicely without. So let's see, I think in coming weeks that may become important. You know. All right, let's get started. I don't know if we can turn some of these lights down and get the slides up a little bit. Great. Okay, is that too dark for you guys? Okay. All right, that was okay, I think you can see the slides, okay.
I'm a traveling man, made a lot of stops all over the world, and in every port I own the heart of at least one lovely girl.
Okay, so people like to travel, and they travel because the world is a big place and there's lots of things to see, and it's a really nice thing. And being able to travel safely and with confidence is something that I've worked on all of my adult career. And so, you know, just in every place creates a memory and a joy of getting to that place and so on. And I hope that we'll be able to continue to do that. But before you go to a place, you end up thinking about it. You go, what's it going to look like? And when I first went to Nepal in 1979, there were very few books in those days, very few picture books. I had no idea what it would look like. And so we just had the ideas in my head. And then when you get to be time to Kathmandu, about 33 minutes out, flying on Thai Airways, you look out the window and finally you see the Himalayas, you know, which still to this day, I don't know how many dozens of times I've flown into Kathmandu, but I always try to sit on the right side of the plane and see those mountains. And then you arrive in Kathmandu, obviously it's different than here, and head up into the mountains as a slightly younger man. And then you get up next to these mountains, and it's still very difficult to fathom. It took me years, you know, to try to think, what am I looking at? But just to help you guys, this is what the Tetons would look like if they were in front of the Himalayas right here. You know, I put them at the right altitude there. So they're big mountains. And then also it's kind of satisfying because they're the biggest mountains. It's not like they're somewhere else, maybe Mars or something, you know, they got bigger mountains, but for us here on Earth, this is going to be it. And then that's Everest in the back there. It's blocked by these other mountains in front. But one interesting thing that I think people are never impressed enough about, but I thought I would mention, is that the top of Mount Everest right there, at 29,000 feet, a little bit plus, is the highest point on Earth, but it's also the highest point that a human being could walk to. If it were any higher, it wouldn't be climbable. The amount of oxygen that you need to get in your blood, you wouldn't be able to get. Even then, there's only a few people who can do it. But I thought it was really interesting. The highest point on Earth is the highest point that, by chance or whatever, that a human being could reach. And so to get there, you have to fly, you often fly into this little airstrip called Lukla, and you may have heard of it, but it's right up against a mountain, so you just have to kind of land going straight into a mountain. If you don't land, you can't turn around. And so if it goes well, then it's like this. But the whole time that you're there, you're thinking about this. And there are very few crashes, actually, at Lukla. This was just one of them. There's only been like two in the last 40 years. But this was 2 weeks before we did that flight. So it was in our mind if you come in a little bit short. And then I went there initially to work at a rescue post up near the base of Mount Everest. It was called in a village called Periche. And I was a budding mountain climber and also had become a doctor, and so I wanted to study altitude illness and work at this place. And my third day there, this woman came in, and then she descended 2,000 feet, and she should have been getting better. She just said she felt tired, had no headache, and so on, laid down, and then went into a coma. And it turned into an incredible drama of her just slipping away and not being able to get a message out to Kathmandu and not being able to find a pilot, and the phones went out, and a snowstorm came, and all, you know, this was my third day, and I'd never seen a case of mountain sickness. To this day, I've never seen one as severe. And so we just kept trying and trying, and we didn't have a radio. Then someone walked up with a radio, and between all that, we finally got in this really bad weather, got a pilot to fly in, and then we carried her out to the helicopter and got her down to Kathmandu, where she made, to my mind, a miraculous recovery. She was in such a deep coma that it didn't seem possible to recover. So I learned something about altitude illness, that not only is it potentially fatal, but it's very reversible if you can get someone down. And so then the Japanese built this pressure chamber. So the idea is that if you can't get someone down because of weather or conditions or nighttime, you could put somebody in a pressure chamber and mimic descent. But this was enormous. It had to be helicoptered up there. It was an enormous thing. It had a generator, and the guy's on the phone there, and that's actually not to talk to the person in there, that's to talk to the person in Tokyo how to work it. And so it never really took off. So then Peter Hackett and Hamish McInnes came up with this kind of big garbage can that you could put people in, and there was a pump there and so on, but also it leaked and it never quite worked. And so then I think it was in my third season there that this woman came down. This is what it's like coming down from up towards Mount Everest Base Camp, and it was snowing again. And she had high altitude pulmonary edema. She had fluid in her lungs. But her guide was carrying this device that no one had ever seen, which was a portable inflatable pressure chamber. And so no one had ever used it. A French guy invented it, and so we put her in it, and we blew it up, and then the show stopped. Hold it, come on. There, okay, there we go. We blew it up, and so then she said we could communicate with her. She goes, I haven't felt this good since I was in Lukla, which is like 5,000 feet lower. And that's where she was, in this pressure chamber. And so I thought, God, this is it. And so I had the card from the guide, and he never wrote me back, and the thing just disappeared from the planet. And so then years later, it resurfaced, reinvented by someone who had never seen the first one. And so this is now called the Gamow bag, and the inventor, Igor Gamow, here in my backyard in Kathmandu, showing the whole thing folded up and along with the pump and so on. So this is something that is now routine to be able to use. Oxygen only lasts so long, and this you can just keep, as long as you can get someone to keep pumping. So Igor Gamow finally did some research and found out that the French guy who invented that initial pressure bag was killed in an avalanche in Chamonix a few months later, and they died with him, and had to be reinvented about 5 years later. So that's kind of an interesting scientific discovery story. But so then, after three seasons of working in the mountains, I heard about a clinic that had opened in Kathmandu, and I was a little at loose ends in my career, if you could call it a career at that point, and so I accepted an offer to work at the clinic, which had been started by David Peterson, who also lives here in the valley, just by coincidence. And so I joined him. It was a different clinic, but we didn't always have snake charmers there. They weren't good for business, and but it is a picture that shows that it wasn't here in Jackson that that the clinic. And then after I left, the Nepali woman who took over the clinic from me built this clinic, and then has expanded into a hospital. Now it's what was an outpatient clinic is now a 20-bed hospital with respirators, intensive care, and is equipped to take care of coronavirus patients if it comes to that. We've had other mysterious lung infections, very similar to coronavirus. It's interesting. And so that's the background of, you know, how then I worked there 15 years, and then from there I moved here. And so the key to travel medicine is understanding the concepts of perception and tolerance of risk, which for this audience is really interesting because I figured this out from the avalanche literature. You know, this is how people talk about risk. The people who really understand and talk about risk the most are avalanche experts. And it really now is through me and through this is spilling over into medicine. It wasn't native to medicine. So when you're talking about perception of risk, you can say, well, this bridge looks really scary, but we don't know how actually dangerous it is. It's just the perception. And especially when, I don't know, your little like 4-year-old daughter is being carried on the back of a basket you know, across the bridge like that. And so it's a question of what you can tolerate, whether you just can overcome your perception and decide that it's okay. And in terms of perception and tolerance of risk, this really is like not everybody would do this. But that's what people do. You know, they their own perception and tolerance is different. And so it's same for travel medicine. I think it's really important. And that's going to be really one of the key things for tonight about as you're planning your trips, you know, try to be make sense, but also it'll be a little bit up to you. It's not so much about medicine as it is about this subjective nature. So if we're going to define risk, then it's the exposure to the chance of injury or loss. Or in relation to medicine, it's the chance of getting a disease. That's what we call the risk of a disease. And so risk, though, can be divided into two parts, a likelihood of getting something, and then the consequences of getting something. So the likelihood of getting something very minor is not very important. There may be a small chance of getting something really severe. So those are two different things that we have to weigh in medicine, and not everybody thinks about it like that. But so likelihood is the probability that something will happen, and in relation to medicine, it's what we call cases over the number of travelers over some period of time, and then we come up with a figure that gives us some kind of likelihood. And then consequences are all the things you could think of. How severe will it be? How much pain? Could you die? Is it reversible once you get it? It will have permanent damage. Is there any treatment available to it to change the outcome? So those are all the consequences that we're talking about with different diseases. And so the holy grail of travel medicine has always been thought to be, if we could just count all the travelers that are going and then had a way to detect all the cases of whatever disease you're concerned about, then you would have cases divided by travelers and you would come up with a risk of disease. So for a long time, when travel medicine came about, because my work in Nepal predated a field of travel medicine. It wasn't until 5 years later that the first meeting in travel medicine happened in Switzerland, and I went to it. But everyone thought, okay, if we just know the statistics, we'll know how to advise people. And it turns out that's not really that helpful. And here's why. Does knowing the risk help? So an actual figure makes the risk seem like it's objective, but perception of risk is highly subjective. And so this is, remember the movie Chicken Run, where these chickens are in like a prisoner of war camp and they're trying to escape becoming chicken pot pie. And so Bunty, the heroine, says, look, Ginger's the heroine, and Bunty says, face it, the chances of us getting out of here are 1,000,000 to 1. And Ginger says, then there's still a chance. Or the even better one is the Jim Carrey, Dumb and Dumber. Yeah, so he's this woman that's way out of his league, and but he's gotten involved. Have you guys seen that? And then he goes, there you go. Yeah. What kind of chance would a guy like me have with a girl like you? She goes, honestly, about 1,000,000 to 1. He goes, then you're saying there's still a chance. So that's perception of risk. So it turns out that the risk of getting a disease called Japanese encephalitis, which is a virus I'll talk about a little bit later, in Asia, is about 1 out of 1,000,000 travelers. So would you say that's a high risk or a low risk? How many say high? How many say low? Okay. How many would take a vaccine to prevent it? There's travel medicine in a nutshell, right? I did a study that looked at the risk of dying if you went trekking in Nepal. That turned out to be about 1 in 6,500. Is that a high risk or a low risk? How many say high risk? How many say low risk? Yeah. So interesting, this was the first paper that was ever, it was only the second paper I ever did, but first paper on the risk of trekking. And so, you know, you send your paper in. This was JAMA, the Journal of American Medical Association, and so it gets reviewed, peer-reviewed. So one of the reviewers wrote, he says, because I had been very neutral about this figure, I just presented it, and he says, the author has to make more of a point that this paper shows how dangerous trekking is. And the other reviewer said, the author has to be more explicit at saying how this shows how safe trekking is. And this is really what I'm talking about tonight, you know, that it's not anything that is really that absolute. And so, you know, what are the chances of seeing the next slide? Darn. Okay, well, what is travel medicine? So travel medicine exists because of the disparity between resource-rich countries and resource-poor countries. Otherwise, we would just call it medicine. Because whether you're in Nepal or whether you're here, if you got sick, you still need a doctor and you still need medicine. But we call it travel medicine because that there's a disparity in the risks, and then there's things that you need to do that exist to help minimize that disparity. But when and so the difference is between going to Paris and eating in an outdoor cafe in Paris or eating outdoor on the Tibetan plateau. You know, there's just a difference in terms of the risk. One is potential for cholesterol and wine poisoning, and the other is for whatever. So what's different in developing countries? I wonder, is there another one of these? No, anyway, I'll see. I need to be able to do it because of timing. But the disposal of human waste, so that's a huge thing. That's what we've been able to accomplish here. We don't even think about it anymore. But not being able to sweep our poop out of the environment causes a lot of sharing of diseases that are spread by poop. And then there's the presence of certain mosquitoes and other disease vectors that we don't have or we've eliminated. And then there's the failure to eradicate certain diseases just because of lack of healthcare infrastructure and so on, so that we try to vaccinate against those diseases if you're traveling. And What that says is, if you can read this sign, it's safe for you to drink this water. It's not really what it says, but it... But people living in these countries develop some immunity and so on, so they're able to get away with drinking water that we couldn't do. And so it turns out that one of the biggest breakthroughs that they've made, everyone thought it was providing clean drinking water and so on, and outhouses and so on, but it didn't do it. You had to... When I went to Nepal in 1979, everyone was still pooping out in the open. There were no toilets in most villages, and so no outhouses even. And so for open defecation, free zone, so no open defecation, and so the creation of toilets, particularly toilets that have a water trap, you pour water in to flush down your poop, and it keeps it from flies and keeps it from in the environment, and this is greatly reduced the risk of diarrhea in these areas. And it's the same, so surprise, the same solutions that allow us to live without the risk of disease, if applied to your destination, work there too. And so that's been something that's really important. And it's hard, no matter how great the view, not to be wondering where the toilet is sometimes when you're traveling in these countries. And as a result, at our clinic, this was a typical Monday morning with stool samples lined up, people with diarrhea. And so so traveler's diarrhea only started, they only became interested in the 1950s after World War II when people started traveling more for leisure. And a lot of Americans went down to Mexico, and about a third of them got diarrhea every time that they went. And no one really knew what the cause was. This was sort of the theories about whether diarrhea was due to a change in diet or a change in climate or things like that, and because they couldn't find the germs. But later they found the germs and realized that it was infection. And so now, 50 years later, knowing all the causes of diarrhea and all the efforts that we make to try to teach travelers how to not get diarrhea, the rate of diarrhea is still the same. And it turns out that there are not a single study that supports the idea that you can decrease your chance of getting diarrhea by watching what you eat. It just has not worked. Because the things that make you sick are restaurant hygiene that have happened behind the scenes that you don't have control of. And so the same things that prevent people getting sick here, restaurant in hygiene instruction and inspection and random inspection that we take kind of for granted, when applied to developing countries, keep people from getting diarrhea. But not eating lettuce, not eating this, being careful about that, and so on. It's still being taught, but I've actually slowed that down quite a bit because I've given a few talks about it, and there's no evidence that it makes any difference. So what does make a difference is seasonality. So it turned out that if you go to Nepal in the spring, you have more than double the risk of getting diarrhea than if you go in the fall. Okay, and also hepatitis, typhoid, and any other stool-borne disease. And it was in the dry season right before monsoon. When I first went over there, everybody says, oh, monsoon season is where people get diarrhea, but it really wasn't. It was in the pre-monsoon season. And then I got a hold of the records of the clinic visits for Nepali children, and it was the same for them, but no one had really noticed it because they were so sure that it was at some other time. And so then we never figured out for sure what it was, but I have a strong suspicion that it has to do with flies. The main time that flies are out in Nepal is in the spring, and then when it rains in the summer, it's like too wet for flies to breed. It drowns them. And then in the fall, there aren't flies. And so, and flies, we've always talked about the risk of diarrhea in flies, but no one really takes it that seriously to really, and so you can't get rid of flies, but you can make sure that they don't have access to poop, which is why the open defecation-free zones has been so successful. And so then the other thing is that people become immune to diarrhea, and no one was able to show that before. But if you live in Nepal continuously for a few years, you can see that the risk of showing up with diarrhea just goes down, but it goes down for 5 or 6 years, continues to go down. And it turns out that this is the same as for kids. As you know, when they're nursing, then they don't get diarrhea very much. And then from like 18 months to 2 years to 5 or 6 years, they get a lot of diarrhea, and it interferes with their growth and their brain development, and it's a big problem. And then you don't see diarrhea being that much of a problem for adult Nepalis because they have this continuous exposure and immunity. And the same thing with expats, the foreign community that's living there. After they've lived there for several years, diarrhea is a minor nuisance. You get some loose stools, but you never get as sick. We see people being carried in to the clinic with fever, diarrhea, and vomiting. They're always tourists or newly arrived expats. So that's something that no one else had been able to show until then. So what we did was, So then, because we hooked up with a U.S. Army research lab in Bangkok, I didn't have the capability of doing this kind of research, but we combined, and actually, I have to tell you, I didn't have any likelihood of ever doing research in my life. The people in my medical school would be laughing if they thought I could do research. I was not a very star medical student. But I got into this good position, and I got some good collaboration, and then we were able to learn a lot. And so we found out that most of the infections that travelers have are due to bacteria that you can treat with an antibiotic. And those infections, can be described as the abrupt onset of relatively uncomfortable diarrhea. So there are more gradual onset, long-term diarrhea like giardia and so on, but the abrupt onset of bad diarrhea is almost always due to bacteria and can be treated with an antibiotic. And until then, until we moved there and started doing this, people said, well, you need a stool sample, you don't know what to give, you don't know what they have. They thought that giardia, amoebas, bacteria, viruses were all equally likely, but it wasn't. It turned out to be mainly bacteria. And so the problem was is that if you go trekking in the mountains, and in those days, very difficult to get rescued by helicopter, but so you would get stranded, you get left at a tea house, your friends would abandon you. It was 100% wives, husbands, friends, they would just leave you they were so determined to get to wherever they were trying to go. So actually, after a while, I had to quit trekking because all I did was rescue people, and that's all I was doing in my practice. So I would start going to the beach instead of going to the mountains because, so people were just laying there. They're so sick, and then they're sick after 5, 6 days, they can't even walk out anymore. Then they have to try to get a helicopter. So what we did is we taught them that if they had the abrupt onset of relatively uncomfortable diarrhea, they could carry the right antibiotic with them and just take it themselves. And no one had ever done this before. No one had thought that the person could be trusted to make a decision and take the medicine and so on. And so, of course, it worked. It kept people from being stranded all over the Himalayas. But then when they went on to Thailand and India and so on, of course, they took the medicine, did the same thing. And then began to talk about it at conferences. Now, anytime you go traveling, your doctor will likely give you an antibiotic to take with you in case you get sick, and that's where it started, was with trekkers in Nepal. Now, there are some issues about resistance and some other things that we won't get into tonight, but that became the standard, and it allowed people to travel with a lot more confidence, because if you don't treat it, it lasts for 3 to 7 days, and most people now are not taking really long trips, so 3 to 7 days out of a 2-week trip is like not very useful. And the way we're going to eventually change this is through kitchen hygiene and not through restaurant hygiene and not through the actions that travelers take. And so this is how we have to change our approach to make the countries that we are afraid of going to more like our countries, and then we can go there. And so and it helps the people there as well. So And so I never had the courage to go into the kitchens of the restaurants that were causing all this disease, I have to say. Also, I didn't have training, but a couple of Colorado State University young women came, and that was their research project. So they just went right in and charted everything. And this is a long time ago, and it's better now, but at the time, they could not have been doing anything worse than they were doing. It was every mistake that you could possibly make to cause diarrhea was being made. And so now it's better, and that was the start of trying to change that. Now, there are vaccines for some of the stool-borne diseases. The most important is hepatitis A vaccine. It's the don't leave home without it vaccine. You only need 2 doses in your life, so there's no reason to go anywhere without getting it. Children now get it routinely, and pretty soon everyone will have it. And then in some countries, typhoid fever, which is another stool-borne disease, is a big risk, and that's an injection every 2 to 3 years, or there's some oral tablets, but I think the injection is a little bit more effective than the oral tablets. So now we're going to switch to altitude illness real quickly. This is that same bag, but this facial expression is something that is really significant. This is how a person with acute mountain sickness looks. It's exactly the same symptoms as an acute alcohol hangover. And no one ever is cracking jokes when they have altitude illness. They just feel terrible, and that's just how they look. And so headache, nausea, fatigue, weakness, and so on. So she's going in the bag for a while, and she'll feel much better in there. And then if it gets worse than that, then it starts to affect your balance, and so the test is like the drunk test. It's to try to walk heel to toe along a straight line like this, and if you can't, then it means that your altitude illness has gotten much more severe. Does anyone know who this person is? Ed Hillary. Yeah, the first guy to ever climb Mount Everest. As he got older, he got some lung disease and made him more susceptible to altitude illness. And so I happened to run into him one time when he was quite sick with altitude illness. And so I was really nervous about it. I thought he should descend. He really didn't want to descend. And so I gave him some dexamethasone. And I said, okay, tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, I'm going to come check you. And the night before, he couldn't walk straight. And said, if you can't do this, we're going to have to fly you out. And so I don't know if you can see here, but he'd been up since 5 practicing. He'd worn a groove in the ground. He could do it forward or backwards, so he was better. But it also showed a little bit about his determination to stay up there. And then And so then the other form of altitude illness is fluid leaking into your lungs. Cerebral edema is fluid leaking into your brain. Pulmonary edema is fluid leaking into your lungs. This is actually the actual case report of one of the first descriptions of high altitude pulmonary edema, which was in some backcountry skiers in Aspen, Colorado, in like 1959. 58 is when it happened. The report came out in 59. So on the left, you can see lungs full of white stuff, which is fluid, and then looking better than that. For travel medicine, one of the big risks is that there's these few high-altitude cities that people like to go to, and from Jackson, it's mainly Cusco. Does anyone know what the altitude of Cusco is? 11,200, right? Like the lower saddle. But people flying in there and sleeping and staying there, turns out that they have about a 35-40% chance of getting altitude illness. It's not a rare or random thing. Altitude illness, I could, you know, maybe we'll give a whole talk on it sometime, but it's based on going faster than your body can adjust, even just by one day, and then this fluid starts leaking. And sometimes you can adjust, and sometimes you have to go down in altitude. So the other places where it occurs is when people go trekking, or from here, a lot of people climb. How many of you have climbed Kilimanjaro? 1, 2, 3, 4. That's pretty good. It seems like it's more because I see so many people. But that's also a very abrupt ascent in terms of getting altitude illness. And so it turns out that that, so this is at different altitudes, 25% of people, even at ski resort altitudes, can get a headache and not feel so good. And I think, there are people who fly to Jackson and get headaches for the first couple of days and stuff. So it's not limited to really high altitude. But as you go up, as I mentioned, it's 35-40% at 11,000 feet, and 84% of those who fly to 12,000 feet get sick. And so this is a helicopter disgorging a whole bunch of people at just about 12,000 feet in the Himalayas, in the Everest region, and 85% of them will be sick overnight, and then they fly out the next day, and so they don't die. So how do you deal with that? Well, there's a drug. The brand name is Diamox. It's also known as acetazolamide, but it turns out that a pretty low dose of this is remarkably effective at preventing altitude illness in a way that turns you into a good acclimatizer. Rather than covering it up or treating the symptoms, it helps you breathe more as you go up in altitude. And those people who increase their breathing more when they go up in altitude don't get altitude illness. So this is something that if you've had altitude illness in the past, particularly. So what it is that everybody is kind of on a curve of whether you're easily acclimatized or whether it's really difficult. I'm actually not a very good acclimatizer, so I started using Diamox after a while and don't have any problems now. But so it's an important thing to know about, because it can help you do these things without suffering quite so much. And then another drug called dexamethasone is not as good as a preventative, because it doesn't help you acclimatize. It does just make your symptoms better. But it can be a remarkable drug for helping get someone down. Or sometimes they give it to people for their summit day on Kilimanjaro, where they're often feeling bad, but they're going to be down later in the day. So the other thing that, I don't want to shock the non-medical audience, but I ended up taking care of a lot of Tibetan refugees who were escaping from Chinese rule and had to go over the Himalayan passes and not with very good equipment. So I learned a lot about taking care of frostbite. And then, does anyone know who this is? Beck Weathers from the Into Thin Air expedition. So the book that John Krakauer wrote about it. So this is how he looked the moment he arrived in my clinic. He had gotten some pretty good treatment at Camp 2 and then got helicoptered out in what was at the time the highest helicopter rescue that had ever been done in the world. And I actually didn't think his hands looked that bad, but I was wrong. And so he lost, so you see, this is after a month, that guy. But so the discoloration, that was all dead. And so he lost his right hand at that discolor mark and all his fingers and thumb on his left hand there because of being stuck out overnight and left for dead. But he wasn't dead. Kind of a miracle. Kind of a miracle. But on the other hand, he was the one person on the expedition that had some trouble with his vision because of the radical radial keratotomy operation that he'd had, which I had just read about before he came down. So I told him actually what had happened to him, because he didn't know why he couldn't see. So he sat out all day without climbing the rest of the mountain, and I think this saved his life. I think that's why his body wasn't completely depleted when he spent the night out. And so then the other thing that I was able to do while I was there was offer free medical care at a Tibetan monastery. I just went out once a week and just saw whoever needed seeing, and this was a monk that was translating for me. And that gave me a close relationship with the head of the monastery named Chökyi Nyima Rinpoche. And through that relationship and the relationship with his father, Tuku Urgen Rinpoche, whom I first met while he was having a massive heart attack on a mountain near Kathmandu. And then, as many of you know, I had a heart attack on Teton Pass. And it was really connected with him, because I couldn't believe that when I met him, he was the first person I ever met who was having a massive heart attack in a remote setting and wasn't afraid at all. And then later, when I had my heart attack, I actually wasn't that afraid. I was trying to concentrate what to do in case I died, but I wasn't really worried. So that had a big meaning for me, meeting him. And so I found that practicing Tibetan Buddhist practice made me be able to be more the kind of doctor that I wanted to be through being more patient and being more open to people and so on, and more consistent. And so we got this idea to have Chökyi Nyingma Rinpoche come actually to Jackson and teach two courses. Some of you went to that course, and we recorded it and turned it into a book, and the book is still around. And so then that's when I talked about the Medicine and Compassion Project. We're still working on this idea that compassion can be something beyond just encouraging people to be more compassionate, but cultivate a kind of natural compassion that makes it easier to be compassionate all the time. And we need that. So a few more diseases before we get to coronavirus, but these mosquito-borne diseases, malaria, yellow fever, and Japanese encephalitis, because these are diseases that have something you can do about it. There's a number of other mosquito-borne diseases, dengue, chikungunya, and Zika, that there are no vaccines at present that are available, and all you can do is try not to get bitten by mosquitoes. Interesting, very few people are aware that malaria was a risk in the United States up till 1951. And so if you were going to go to the South, even Florida, I don't know why Florida wasn't in there, it usually is, but you would have had to take malaria pills to go there. So we got rid of it. And so malaria also was all throughout England, Scotland, Europe. Malaria was all over the world. But we pushed it back and then stopped in other countries. And so one of the big initiatives of the Gates Foundation was this idea, well, why is it okay for us to live without all the risk and death and everything associated with malaria? And so there's some big projects to try to continue the eradication of malaria. But through drainage of swamps, insect control, putting screens on houses, and treating people when they're sick, they were able to eliminate malaria in this country completely, and throughout Europe and so on, but now it's still in a lot of other places. So in terms of travelers, you say, well, is there a risk of malaria? Well, how do we determine that? Well, it's a combination of getting data from the health authorities in that country, and then the reliability of that data, the diagnosis of malaria and so on is always kind of an issue in data keeping. And then our travelers returning from those places with malaria, that also gives you an idea of an ongoing existent risk. And so the problem is that drawing these maps turns out to be another exercise in perception and tolerance of risk, but in this case, perception and tolerance of other people's risk. And so the guy who was in charge of malaria for the CDC for a long time just thought there was much less harm in having everybody take malaria pills than in making more accurate maps. So this was the CDC map of Nicaragua, for example, red being malaria areas. But this is a map from a commercial company. Why does it go by itself? Are you, you're pushing? Okay. They don't want you to see this commercial map. Here, why don't you try pushing? I won't push. There. And so this is what a map by a different set of people looking at the same data deciding where the risk of malaria is. And so this is what's subjective about travel medicine and what's difficult for a practitioner. Do I go by CDC or do I go by TRAVAX? And then, again, it becomes a part of the traveler's perception and tolerance of risk. You know, if to some people say, I don't want to take any chance at all, I'll take the pills. I say, I don't want to take the pills, but if you think it's safe. So that's really what it comes down to, because it's The guy at the CDC, in fairness, he said, it's hard for me to draw a line on a map and know there's malaria on one side and no malaria on the other side. You know, how can I really do that and stick to that? So that's the challenge of travel medicine. But then in some countries like Kenya, then you don't have that problem. There's malaria throughout the whole country. Makes it easier from a travel medicine point of view. So, except for one kind of malaria that came out in the last few years in Borneo, malaria, human malaria, was a human-only disease. And so the idea was that if you could treat every human being at the same time, even if you still had mosquitoes, there would be no longer any malaria parasites for them to pick up. Malaria parasites don't live in mosquitoes. I mean, they infect mosquitoes temporarily, then the mosquito dies. But 99% of all malaria germs in the world are in people right now as we speak. So we know where they are, but we just have to get to them with a medication. And the idea, one of my closest friends was the head of malaria eradication at the Gates Foundation, Alan McGill, and sadly he died prematurely. But he had this idea that if you had a medicine, like a single pill that stayed in the blood for about a month, so that you didn't get reinfected right away, that you could eradicate malaria without a vaccine and without changing, going after the mosquitoes. So maybe that'll still happen. And so there's three drugs currently. There's a fourth one coming out called tafenoquin, but I won't go into that. But Malarone by far is the safest, best. You only have to take it every day while you're there and then just for a few days after you leave. The other ones you have to take for a month after you go and take for a little bit before you go there to build it up. So that, and Malarone has been really well tolerated. It doesn't have the severe side effects that are associated with mefloquine to some extent, but kind of also been blown out of proportion. And so yellow fever is the only regulated disease in the world. So this is one they can require you to show proof of vaccination before you go there. And the reason is to try mostly to protect that country from the disease. So because it's regulated, a lot of people are vaccinated. So there's only been 10 cases in travelers in the last 40 years. But that doesn't mean that there's no risk. It just, I think, means a lot of people are vaccinated. And but there's a, and so these are the places, kind of yellow on yellow here, but sub-Saharan Africa and the whole Amazon drainage, but now most all of Brazil compared to this map, when this map came out. And so like I say, the regulations are to try to prevent the spread of the disease rather than to protect you. But 20 years ago, we found out that yellow fever vaccine can occasionally cause yellow fever rather than prevent it when you get it. And that's bad. That's not what we're going for. And it has been fatal to some recipients of the vaccine, and that risk increases with age. So over age 60, the risk goes up. And so then you have to make a decision about the risk of the disease, the need for the certificate, because sometimes you can't get in, although you can write a kind of waiver. And so it becomes really kind of tricky. It took a lot of the fun out of travel medicine when you had to tell people that you can get yellow fever vaccine, but it could kill you. And people don't like that. I don't know why. But so in some destinations, the actual risk of the disease is so low that the risk of the vaccine and the risk of the disease become really close. It's tough numerically to make that decision. So the way I often frame it is if you get the vaccine, your risk is about a week, and then it's over, and then the rest of your life you can travel around in yellow fever areas without worrying about it. If you don't get the vaccine and you go anyway, then you have to kind of be worried about getting the disease the whole time you're there, and it's not as carefree. But this is, again, perception and tolerance of risk at an individual level. And it went from being needing to get it every 10 years to now lifelong. Japanese encephalitis is basically all throughout all of Asia. But think of it, it's the same virus as West Nile virus that we have here. It's a different strain, but it's the same thing. It goes between birds. Humans are an accidental host. And it turns out that we have this here. So like in 2016, there were 11 cases. And so that's 19 per million. If you go traveling, it's 1 per million. But there's a vaccine. So Japanese encephalitis in travelers is the least risky disease, least risk of disease for which a vaccine exists. And so it's, and I just served on a committee that rewrote the recommendations for U.S. travelers, and it's really tough because there's no set kind of traveler or location. There's just these random cases that people get. And one thing that really messed it up just a month ago was an 11-year-old girl who got Japanese encephalitis in the beach areas of southern Thailand, which were thought to not be a risk. And now she's brain damaged and not going to probably make a full recovery. And so should she have been vaccinated? She didn't, wouldn't have met the criteria that we came up with for, you know, in our committee. If you vaccinated every traveler to prevent one case, it would cost about $800 million to prevent one case. So that's the reality of it. So there's only one or two cases per year, but you need to make an individual decision. The longer you travel, the less luxurious accommodation, the more closer to rice paddies and so on, then you should get vaccinated. Vaccine costs, see, bad disease, 33% die, and half of the others are brain damaged permanently. Really, you know, bad disease. Anything with encephalitis in it is something you don't want to get. And then, do you want to push it? So two doses, the dose is very expensive in the U.S. About $385 a dose, takes two doses and then a booster in a year if you're still traveling. And you can get different vaccines, but equally effective once you get to Asia for $25 to $50 that are just a single dose. So this is a strange thing about being in a really rich country where things are way too expensive, even for rich travelers. And then you could, you're telling people to go to another country to get the vaccine so they can afford to be protected. It's kind of a strange aspect of travel medicine. So rabies is something that people often don't think about when they're planning their trip. So any mammal bite. In Kathmandu, we have a place called the Monkey Temple. I don't know why they call it that. It's like running a gauntlet of monkeys. But so a lot of people are bitten by monkeys, but monkeys don't have rabies very much in the monkey population. But it's dogs that you need to look at. Now, that dog is right behind that guy. But if you're bitten by a monkey, you still have to get rabies shots. And so this one picture, and so this is what a monkey bite looks like a human bite. And so this picture made me think that monkeys could get infected by dogs because they kind of interact with each other, live in the same environment. But then I met some wildlife biologists who had been studying temple monkeys for like 10 years, and they said they never saw a monkey get bitten by a dog because they were too fast. And so I thought, oh, that's interesting. But monkeys do have rabies every once in a while. And then I ran across this picture, which shows there's at least some interaction between monkeys. I would love to know what's going on in this picture. You know, I mean, what? You know, how did that happen? And the monkey looks so comfortable, you know, and the dog seems very tolerant. This is a monkey bite on someone's arm. You know, mostly it happens when people have food or somehow on them and the monkey jumps on them and so on. So the bites that we deal with tourists are often not very severe, but still a risk for rabies, and they have to get shots. And I'll try not to dwell on this next picture if I can, but these are the kinds of exposures that Nepali kids are getting from living around dogs, and very severe exposures. And so the other thing is that bat rabies, you know, we heard about it in Teton County in the last year because there have been some rabid bats, but bats all around the world are considered capable of transmitting rabies, and so any contact, skin contact with a bat requires some rabies shots. And this woman 34-year-old orthopedic resident from the Netherlands. They actually called me about this case when she presented in the Netherlands, because I've done a lot of work on rabies. But a bat had flown into her face while she was camping in Kenya, and she had a little scratch on her nose, but she didn't think anything of it. Nobody around there thought that they had seen bat rabies, but a month later she developed rabies and died. So I always mention this because you might not think. And also, this case, which you may remember from a couple of years ago. So, you know, we all have bats in our houses and have known people who had bats in our houses. So the main thing is that if you have a known contact or you have spent the night in a room with a bat while you're asleep, that's enough to be worth getting rabies shots. There's enough stories of people who have died of rabies who were aware of a bat in their house at some time, but weren't aware of being bitten. Now, people have bats in their roofs and live there for years, and like in the park and some of the cabins and so on. But if there's been an actual bat in a bedroom when the bedroom door has been closed or something like that, then you don't know if you've been bitten. In this particular case, the woman woke up because the bat landed on her arm, and she kind of swatted it away like this. And in the morning, the bat was gone, and they examined her arm and couldn't see any kind of bite or anything like that. But she didn't consult anyone. If she had called down to here, she would still be alive. But and so the main thing is that, and she was the first human to ever die of rabies in Wyoming, as far as we know. And but look at the size of the teeth on the bat. So this is why you can't rely upon seeing them. People have examined, looked with magnifying glasses for bites and not seen them. And so we can't rely on that. So if the bat has had contact with your skin, then we have to assume you've been bitten and you would need shots to prevent rabies. So that's, I just wanted to make that part of the thing. There's two strategies. You can get some shots before you go and it makes it easier to treat, but I won't go into that right now. Also, a lot of you, you know, travel with children or want to travel with children. And so, again, in the reason for this made-up magazine, just to let you know, there is no magazine for irresponsible parents, is that in travel medicine, the pediatricians who were in travel medicine were way overprotective of children. They were saying you shouldn't go anywhere with any child who's under two because they won't remember and you're just exposing them to risk. And I go, God, if you don't do stuff with your kid because they don't remember, you might as well just put them in a closet for 2 years and not take such good care of them. So there are a lot of reasons. You're still nursing, you want a holiday with your child, you're more relaxed. Traveling with children has some great benefits. We traveled with our children, lived with overseas. It makes families closer together. You spend more time traveling internationally than you would ever see your child here because of school and activities and so on. So I spent 6 months researching whether it was really true, whether kids really die traveling because it's really dangerous, and it really doesn't happen. It's not any more dangerous. The things that kids die of when they're traveling is drowning in swimming pools that don't have fences around them, drowning in the ocean because they're not used to it, car accidents because they're not restrained. But in terms of infectious disease and other kinds of things, you couldn't find examples. Very, very rare. So I became an advocate for being able to travel wisely with kids and not try to set records with them, which is sometimes happens. Parents do that. You know, they want to be the youngest kid to get to Everest Base Camp or something, and that's not good motivation. But the main thing is that if the parents have traveled in developing countries before, they'll do a lot better. If they're really nervous about it, it's hard to bring your young child into that environment. But even so, you can do it, but it works better if you've done it before. And then also, orient the whole trip around the children. Don't attach children to an adult trek or an adult trip or sailing trip or something like that. If you're going to travel with your kids, make it a trip with the kids, and then you can really enjoy it. It can be really fun. I hope I haven't worn you out with all the travel medicine stuff first, but we'll talk a little bit about what I think many of you came here to hear about.
Hello.
Okay.
No? Okay, thank you. All right. Now I feel like Mick. So the reason it's called coronavirus, as you must have read, is that these little protrusions look like they're sticking out of a crown. So corona means crown, and that's why it got that name. It's a group, not a huge group of viruses, but they're associated with common colds, and they are thought to originate from bats, and then somehow get into animals, and then through these markets in China where people eat animals that we wouldn't think to eat, they get into human beings and have caused these outbreaks. So there have been now three big outbreaks associated with these what are called coronaviruses. And I think I had a slide about, okay, so the nomenclature, just because you see it in the press, is that they decided to call the disease COVID-19. They gave a name, a taxonomic name to the virus called SARS-CoV-2, which no one uses. And then I think it's going to always be called coronavirus, so don't worry about it. But that's why you see these different names. So COVID-19 is meant to be the disease. The other name's meant to be the virus, but it'll be coronavirus for a long time, I think. So SARS was named severe acute respiratory syndrome, same kind of virus spread from civet cats in these same markets in China. MERS-CoV was a Middle East respiratory syndrome that probably came to humans from camels, maybe from bats originally. And then the COVID-19 is the one that we're dealing with right now. So just to compare, so SARS only was an outbreak from November of 2002, and it was only really recognized in February of 2003, but they later found out it had been circulating in China for a few months before that. There were a total of about 8,000 cases and what we call a case fatality rate of about 7%. And then MERS was a more severe infection, and it has been circulating on and off. There was a big epidemic in like 2014 to 2016, I think, but in 2012 is when it was first noted. And then again, a case fatality rate of 34%. That means 34% of people who got sick with this virus died from it. And both of those two viruses were more severe and less contagious than the one that we're dealing with. And so they were able to cut short a lot of the epidemics, because once a person was identified, if you put them in a hospital, if the healthcare workers could protect themselves, which was an issue because with SARS, a number of healthcare workers died taking care of these patients before they figured out how to protect themselves. And then you could identify contacts and isolate them, and if they didn't get sick, then they no longer are a risk to someone else. And so that the idea that started off with the coronavirus worked, actually, because these were different viruses with different contagiousness. And so with the COVID-19, the figures are going up every day. This 90,284 was just from this afternoon. It'll be more tomorrow. 3,000 deaths. So if you do that calculation, it's 3.4%. But because of lack of testing and identifying of mild cases, the actual case fatality rate is likely to be much less, people think it'll be somewhere between 1 and 2%, but we don't really know. Once we start widely testing, we may find like everyone in this room has it and is not sick, and then you know a few people might get really identified and get sick and die. So we don't know that for sure, but the current estimates are somewhere between 1 and 2%. But because they've only been testing really sick people, the case fatality rate looks higher right at the moment. But this is the thing that really you need to think about, is this reproductive number. And so one person with the coronavirus is thought to infect on average about two other people. Between two and three is what they think. And so that doesn't sound like that much, but it's exponential. And so if one person comes back from Italy with the disease and infects just two people, but those two people infect two others each in the next generation, and those four people infect two others each in the next generation, by 10 transfers of this virus, one person has infected 2,000 people. And that's what we're up against with this reproduction rate. That's why that's so important, even though it doesn't sound like much. Seasonal influenza has something like 1.2. So what kills people with the coronavirus? This is a normal chest x-ray. Those things are just showing that the person's not rotated and they're straight. And so you've got the heart there, the outline of the heart, which has got blood in it and muscle, so it shows up a little denser. The lung tissue is less. The blood vessels are, you can see them for a while, but then they peter out because they get really small. So this is a normal chest x-ray, and then so this is a SARS x-ray. So if coronavirus is similar to that, and we haven't had a lot of good descriptions, then the lungs, not just pneumonia, but they begin leaking fluid, and what we call acute respiratory distress syndrome. And so when fluid leaks into your lungs, you drown. And the distance between the air sacs and the blood vessels gets longer, and oxygen can't make it across there. So you intubate someone, you give them 100% oxygen, you use some pressure, and you try to get some oxygen in your blood. But if you don't have working lungs, you can't survive. And that's how people die from this disease. And if they can be supported with respiratory support, and then they fight off the disease, then they'll recover. That's why people are starting to talk about availability of ventilators and so on as being really critical to the public health care of this disease. So everyone starts off just getting a cold and a cough and a fever, but a few people go on to get this severe respiratory distress, and that has seemed to be something that happens more in older people, which kind of scary now that I'm getting to be an older person. And so the risk associated with travel is twofold. So this is the main thing tonight. Actually, you've sat nicely through all the other travel medicine stuff, which I hope was okay. But so there's the risk when you're thinking about travel in relation to the coronavirus. There's the risk of the getting the disease through being on airplanes, being in airports, being at events, being in hotels, whatever it is. And right now, because of the population of the planet and the number of cases, your chances of actually catching the disease while traveling is probably pretty low. But this risk is changing, you know, as we speak. But the main thing that I've been thinking about in relation to travel is the risk of getting stuck, the risk of having your life disrupted. And so what brought this really home for me was this report of this hotel in the Canary Islands, okay, which you probably heard about. But so there was a group of Italians that came to the hotel, and then a couple of them got sick and got diagnosed with coronavirus, and the police came and locked everybody in the hotel, 1,000 people. And so then they began testing people and getting histories and stuff, and gradually started releasing people. Some people are still under quarantine. But even the people who've been released, can't get a flight home because the airline won't fly them because they're not beyond their two-week quarantine period or they haven't been tested. So when you set out into this world of international travel, I mean, a week, 2 weeks ago, if you had said, where would be a safe place that I could get a beach holiday? I said, well, why don't you go to the Canary Islands? They're an island. There's been no cases in Africa, you know. And so this is going to be the problem in picking a destination because the friend of mine asked me about, you know, do you think it would be safe for us to go skiing in Austria over spring break? And so then, just as I got off the phone with him, then this report came out of a hotel in Innsbruck, Austria. And so same thing, you know, locked people in the hotel. They went through them a little faster, but nine are still stuck there for 2 weeks as a precaution. And so the risk of not being able to get home, not being able to carry on, and then actually being stranded in a hotel with a bunch of people who might have the disease, think of that cruise ship, that, to me, was more of the issue, the uncertainty surrounding travel. If you just think about it, and just in terms of your personal chance of catching the disease, that may remain low, but that's compounded by whatever your destination is and whether you want to be hospitalized in that destination and whether they can actually provide the care that you need. So that's the main concerns, I think, that in terms of travel and this disease right now. And so then I was also looking, I was reading, and so, you know, some of you have talked to me, you've taken out trip insurance, but when you're taking out trip insurance, which would make sense if you're planning trips in the next 6 months or so, what triggers that? Can you just decide not to go and get your money back, or does there have to be a travel advisory or something more official before they'll kick in? And if you just decide you don't want to go, you may lose all your money. So that would be the main question to ask, is it cover coronavirus? Some insurance companies are already charging a surcharge for coronavirus cancellation. And then if your flight is canceled, this is in Europe, I don't know what they do here. In Europe, they have laws about this, but you should be able to be compensated. But there's a thing that if you didn't book your whole itinerary at the same time and had two separate itineraries, that only the actual flight that they're not flying would you be compensated for. And even if it caused you to miss your next flight, unless it was linked in the itinerary, you wouldn't get compensated for it. So there's some issues that you'll need to become educated about as you're booking trips in coming months. So in preparing for this talk. Now, this is the this Johns Hopkins map that you've heard about. It's available to the public. This was yesterday afternoon. This was this afternoon. 86 to 90,000 just keeps going up and shows where the disease is. And so then, you know, Israel, which has a lot of travelers, there are a lot of Israeli travelers in Asia and so on, just said, look, if you don't have to travel, why don't you just not go? You know, and I don't know when other countries will start kind of encouraging people not to head out, but this is already happening in terms of what Israel. I don't think they make it so they can't go, but they're actually saying if you don't genuinely have to go, and also that helps protect Israel because everyone who goes has to come back at some point, and then what? You know, how do you monitor that? So it happens that one of my closest friends is been working in the division of quarantine at CDC for 30 years. And so I asked him the other day in preparation for this talk, and he said, I think this is really important to bear in mind. Things are hard enough to predict 24 hours from now. Impossible even in 2 to 4 weeks. Anyone who tells you that they can is either deceiving you or naive. So it's a very fluid thing. It could get far worse than we imagine. It could end up being better than we imagine. And that's why people are now calling me about their trips, like 2-3 people a day. And so sometimes they're calling me to book a travel medicine appointment for a trip that might be in May or June, and I'm kind of saying, you know, we don't need to do it this far in advance, and maybe you don't want to get shots that you're not going to need or buy medicine that you're not going to need. Let's just wait a little bit and see. So no one really knows how this is going to go, and this guy whose whole life has been spent trying to figure out what's going to happen says, it's just changing too rapid. Look what's happened in the U.S. just in the last 7 days, you know, from no cases outside of the ones that they flew back to now. And now that they had problems with their testing kit, and so lack of cases may just be lack of testing. And now as they make that more available and more readily test, I think we'll find that it's all over. And then we'll have to figure out what to do about that. And then one thing that really jumped out at me, and I wanted to make a mention of it tonight, they said, if you haven't had your flu shot, go ahead and get it. And there was a pretty good reason. The reason is that people still get really sick from the flu, and you could end up in the hospital with the flu with something that was preventable, taking up a bed for somebody who couldn't prevent it with coronavirus. So I think that's really sensible. The current flu vaccine's about 50% protective, so that's half the cases are prevented. And I think that would greatly, if you haven't already had it, could be something very positive for both yourself and for the community if you're not just thinking about yourself in that sense. Okay, so almost done. Sorry, long talk. So I wanted to show you that there's some reason for being in travel medicine. You get to fly on the plane with everybody and stand at the side of the stage while they're playing and hope that they don't drop dead. Because you realize that if they do, that there'll be 50,000 people with cell phones recording everything that you do. And you could end up in jail if you don't do it right. But I wanted to show you, you know, that things change. You know, if you're fortunate enough to travel when you're younger and then you travel later, but it's always still great to travel. Things change, sometimes they get better. This is what the aid post at Periche looked like when I went there in 1979. And then this is what it looks like, you know, 30 years later. And, you know, on the other hand, you know, they now have individual rooms with attached Western-style flush toilets, as opposed to what was going on here. Can you back it up one? Oh, okay, so from here, there was one outhouse here and one outhouse over here. That was it. And when you woke up in the morning, if you had diarrhea, you had to make a cruel decision whether to run to this one, which was closer, but there could be someone in it, or make it across all these fences, which was not easy to do if you were trying to hold in diarrhea, but at least then there wouldn't be somebody in it, to having a room with an attached Western flush toilet to sit on, and the mountains still look the same. So, I mean, things change, but they sometimes get better. And then in Kathmandu, 1979, when I was first there, to the same corner. Now, in fairness, I'm looking the other direction than I was, but it's still the same corner. I'm still standing in the same spot. So, you know, Kathmandu has grown into a big city since then, but I still like going there. It's harder than it used to be. And but on the other hand, they're building resorts like this so people who are not necessarily want to trek can still be in the mountains, see the Himalayas. Looks like Jackson Lake Lodge, doesn't it? I was just in this a few months ago, brand new hotel built by Japanese with a spectacular view from a dining room or in this case, the lobby. And so things change, but they don't necessarily always just get worse. And then there still are the places that you can only get to by walking. This was this is very dear to my heart because I had a chance to do a meditation retreat in this place for 7 days. It took me 11 days to walk there, but then I only stayed there for 7 days. But still, these places still exist if you search them out. And so that's that's my talk. Thank you. Okay, now the questions. Yes. I have no idea. Iran, she's wondering what's going on in Iran. I have no idea. Yes.
Two quick questions. Conventional wisdom is that the masks don't help you from getting the disease. It might help you from not infecting somebody. And secondly, how long can the bacteria, the virus, live outside of the body? If somebody coughs on an airplane,
well, you know, they're still working on this stuff. The questions about masks and questions about persistence of the virus in the environment. And so with masks, they feel that wearing a mask out in the environment doesn't offer you any significant amount of protection. And even a really tight mask, which you can't wear for any length of time and comfort. Some people feel that a mask could actually increase your risk because you're constantly adjusting it and having to move it to eat and all this stuff, so your hands in your face more than if you're not wearing a mask. If you're sick, then people in Asia, long before this, were wearing masks to try to protect other people. But as someone said today, that if you're sick, you shouldn't be out in public anyway, you know, wearing a mask, but it could help protect those at home with you if you're wearing a mask and covering up some of your breathing and sneezing. They feel that the virus can persist for numbers of hours on certain surfaces. They're still working that out. So yes, don't know. If in certain humid conditions or under certain circumstances, it could be longer. But as it dries out, it can't survive. I don't know. I mean, you know, the healthcare workers have died already. They died with SARS. Those hazmat suits are really necessary, and there's a question whether there's enough around, but that's something that's not overdoing it. If you're suctioning or, you know, when a person's on a respirator, there's just constantly throwing out stuff in the air when you try to suction and clean those and so on. And so they need to be completely protected, and they weren't in the early days of SARS and so on. So they're really trying to do that, but they haven't maybe stockpiled enough, and we don't know. Yeah. I have no idea. you know, I've spent about 30 hours on this talk because I'm no expert on coronavirus or those kind of things. I mean, I to the extent that I've been to talks in travel medicine and SARS and MERS, people keep insisting that hand washing is the most important thing. And the important thing to remember is that hand washing with soap and water, running water, is more effective than the hand sanitizers. There's a way to think that somehow alcohol must be better than soap and water, but the message is that soap and water is a lot better, and they came up with a magic figure of 20 seconds, which gives you something to aim for, you know, while you're washing and trying to get germs off of your hands. In the absence of that, sanitizers are better than not. Whether wiping down the tray table or the seats or your armrests in planes, I don't know if people really know. It's going to just do. The one other thing, though, to remember is that everyone thinks that planes are these huge incubator for passing diseases, but they're actually pretty filtered air, and the air is going across in horizontal slices. It's not being sent up and down the length of the plane. So for most epidemiologic reaction to disease, to a diseased passenger, it's only a couple rows on each side of that passenger. Now, not knowing which passenger is sick doesn't help you know which row to sit in. Some people did some research. I say I've been reading about this stuff, that sitting in a window seat exposes you less to people going by in the aisle, and you're less tendency to get up because you can't get up, and so therefore then you're not touching more surfaces in the plane and so on. So if it's a shorter flight and you can make it without peeing, which many of us who are at high risk for the disease can't make it without peeing, and so those are some of the things. I think that what's going to be necessary is canceling things. I noticed that there was a big International Society of Infectious Disease. This is the big society of infectious disease in the world. And they were going to be meeting this month in Malaysia, but they've canceled. And partly because everyone is busy working on the coronavirus back home, not just because they didn't want to go there. But I think that any kind of big conventions and things like that are going to start getting canceled. I think the Olympics are just hanging by a thread right now. And but no one wants, the Japanese don't want to believe that. So, John.
In my whole lifetime, three of these coronaviruses, is that good luck? Or is that they're really common or they're really uncommon?
I think it's uncommon. I think that population, the spread, any disease can be anywhere in the world in 24 hours now. That didn't used to be the case, you know. But I did want to say, it reminded me to say one thing and then I'll ask you questions. But, you know, this idea that only 1% or 2% of people die from this disease, and some people are saying, well, you know, that's good. I mean, got 98% chance of not dying. But on the other hand, if it's really contagious, the number of deaths is going to be way more than we want to imagine. And even though this may come nowhere near what happened in 1918-19, it's the example because the death rate from that disease, which we think of as the killer flu that went around the world, is only 1.5% or so. But if you infect 500 million people, then you have 50 million people who have died. And so that's what has the epidemiologists really worried. And so taking comfort in the fact that it's not very lethal, you know, there's now 3,000 people who have died who probably most of whom would not be dead right now if this disease hadn't gotten loose. So that's the problem. There are some other questions here, yes. They're afraid that might be true, but they don't know yet. I mean, think how you would find that out. You've got to be culturing people, seeing if they have the disease, see whether people in contact with them get sick, see how long that took. I mean, there's all these things that we actually just don't know about this disease. But the fear is that people will be contagious for some period of time, even though they're not sick, and then how do you contain that? That's why these other coronaviruses were more easy to contain because it seemed like people had to be sick in order to transmit them. Back here, yeah.
Okay. So are you expecting to see them here?
Am I expecting what? I wouldn't know. I mean, why wouldn't we? People come from all over the world. And now, so here's the interesting thing, and also just I want to point out, I'm not the public health authority for this valley, and people are working on that, and they'll be putting out information and so on. So I'm not speaking for public health. I was just talking in terms of what we know about travel. But I lost my train of thought. You were saying, are we going to see it here? These cases in Washington, Santa Clara County, in Oregon, now in New England, and so on. And as Addie pointed out earlier tonight, they're on the coast so far. It's interesting, you know, like, why aren't they in Kansas and Tech, you know, I mean, but the question is, where did those cases come from? Because they made a point that there's no direct contact with someone who had been in China or Iran or Italy, but somebody, they didn't magically travel in the stratosphere and then drop out. So the, in terms of asymptomatic travel, in terms of people who are not so sick, the symptoms are like a cold. If it was like a rash that showed up on your face, you could avoid them, you know. So it is being passed somehow. And it's being passed in a way right now that is not very traceable. We'll know more as they expand testing. And when they have cases and deaths and can test everyone in their environment, they'll know, does everyone have it or is only just a handful of people have it? We'll know more about that. She's asking about who, what makes you at higher risk, and they mentioned diabetes, heart disease, lung disease. So it just seems like older people who were known to be sick with other things were more likely to die from the disease. That's all I think that they know at this point. But healthy people, younger people have also died. It's something individual. There's some reaction, something that goes on, an overreaction some people feel of the immune system, which then causes all these blood vessels to get leaky and so on. So that may be genetic, it may be something else. Yes?
How long would it last if you get just, say, a normal case of coronavirus and you don't die?
Yes, how long does it last if you don't die? And, you know, I think they're thinking it's like 5 to 7 days like a cold. The question is, how long are you infectious after that? And I don't think people know that, you know.
Yes.
So the question is, if it's so contagious, will everybody get it and get immune or succumb? They don't know. I mean, it's interesting. People are pointing to the fact that with the Spanish flu, that it came through in a spring, kind of died down over a summer, and then took off the following fall again because it was still around. This, if it's so contagious, this may be a disease that's with us like seasonal flu, but we'll get a vaccine eventually, you know, for it. And the other thing they don't know is whether it gives lasting immunity after you have it. Apparently, with the cold viruses that are in the coronavirus family, the immunity doesn't last very long after getting sick. So they don't know. This one being more severe infection may give lasting immunity, but they actually don't know. That would be nice if you got it and then you were immune for life. You could take care of people who were sick, you know. They'd had that with Ebola. Once you survived Ebola, those people were not at risk of getting Ebola, and they could actually take care of people and their family. Yes, a couple more, and then we'll let you go. Yeah, thought about domestic travel. I think at this point, domestic travel is going to end up being like foreign travel. You know, as the disease spreads from state to state, you know. I mean, you go someplace, go to a meeting, take a chance that someone at the meeting is sick, you come back and infect your community. And, you know, but once it's out, then not going anywhere doesn't seem to be the solution either. It is trying to have people be careful. But I think what my friend said is the thing we don't know. You know, day by day it's changing. And so, but I would think that domestic travel would be no different than international travel once the disease is firmly established here. Yes, one more. Thank you.
As an infectious disease specialist, why would you speculate that coronavirus is sparing children?
Yeah, that, I mean, you know, it, no one knows. Why are children not getting so sick with the vaccine? I mean, with the disease. You know, first of all, when you're looking at new diseases, you're just looking at what's happening. It's descriptive epidemiology. Then later you can design some experiments to see, you know, kids' immune systems at a certain really young age are not very developed, and so maybe you need a really strong immune response to get really sick, but at a certain age they have a really good immune system, and so I don't think we know the answer. The other question that didn't come up is about vaccine development, and I just wanted to say a couple things because To make a vaccine, you have to find the part of the virus that causes an immune response. And so that's the part that your body recognizes. And so they have to determine that whatever they're making the virus part of the virus, that it actually stimulates an immune response. And then you can even get, and then it's not just a matter of getting the virus and putting it in some water and putting it in you, but there are adjuvants, there's other chemicals, there are things they're mixed with that make it better, and this is kind of trial and error to make a more effective vaccine. And then a number of my friends have been involved in vaccine development a lot. And so you can have a vaccine that gets a good measurable immune response and doesn't protect against the disease. So there's three phases of studies, phase one, phase two, phase three. So phase one, you make a vaccine and you put it into 50 people or so, and then see that they don't die, you know? I mean, that it's safe. You see if they have a lot of bad effects. Everyone has fever or something, it's too strong. So then you put it in a couple hundred people and try to see if they get exposed to the disease and see if it offers any protection. And then you do a lot bigger study to try to show that it really is working in a large population. And so those all three phases you have to go through. I mean, you know, you can't just throw it together and give it to 3,000 people and find that it all causes something really horrible. So that's why they're saying it'll take a year, year and a half, and a minimum to have a vaccine that's out on the market. And then if the nature of this disease is such that it's just going to be around, then it'll become like another seasonal influenza that's potentially fatal, and there'll be a vaccine at least. Medication is another issue, and so there are some antiviral medications that work against flu, but so far those ones have not been working against this virus. And so maybe that's because the virus causes, it's not just a matter of killing the virus, but once that other, you know, overreaction is going on, that's what's actually dealing with. We don't know, but they're trying a lot of those. If they get lucky and get something that really diminishes the severity of the disease, particularly if given early when the virus is still growing, maybe it can prevent that severe lung disease or something like that. So they're working on that as well. Yes?
As a reality check, I am of the understanding that a very significant number of people die every year from the flu in America, mm-hmm. a very large number. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's about 0.1% of people with flu die, and the very young and the very old being more susceptible to that. But it shows that when you have a disease that's familiar, like West Nile virus in Wyoming, we don't spend a moment worrying about it. We go to Asia, the same disease, there's a vaccine, we try to decide whether to spend $800, you know, to prevent it. So, you know, the fact that a lot of people die from flu is meaningless. A lot more people will die who wouldn't have died of flu, you know, from this disease. So that's what we're dealing with right now. Well, I have about 5 trips planned. You know, as my friend said, I'm waiting to see. I'm supposed to go to New York the beginning of April to give a talk on rabies. And then I'm supposed to go to Canada, then I'm supposed to go to England and teach a medicine and compassion retreat in June, and then I want to go back to Nepal in the fall. So I'm just like everyone else, waiting to see what makes sense and whether it's sensible to go on these trips or not. Well, I would go to England today, but I might not go next week. I mean, that's what you said, you know, really, this is what you're dealing with. Now there's just a dozen cases in England, but with more testing and all that stuff. It just, I'm not sure that I want to be abroad dealing with a lot of difficulties of canceling flights back, or, you know, that's the other thing that I was talking about, the logistics of dealing with the disease as opposed to just the concern about catching the disease. I think that the main take-home lesson, if there is one from tonight, is that pay attention. You know, if you want to plan some trips, plan them, have some financial backup, you know, in terms of insurance that would actually cover you, and be prepared to not go if it didn't look like it was sensible to do that. And I've been helping people try to decide, but I don't have any secret inside knowledge. It's just pointing out the realities of being out and about, being locked down in a hotel somewhere, not being able to get on a plane to fly home until this is more of a sure thing. If it's true that warm weather will make it less of an issue, then trips that are already planned in the summer might be better. We might be in the middle of something that's really terrible by that time. So I think the other take-home message is my friend's slide. We don't know what's going to happen in 24 hours. No one knows what it's going to be 2 to 4 weeks. No one knows 3 or 4 months from now. Nobody knows. So the public health efforts are trying to prepare people to take measures, to be sensible, and then the stockpiling of enough supplies and things. You know, if you end up on a respirator, you know, I think there's just a handful of respirators in this valley, you know. And so then the other ones are all going to be full, and how are you going to get there? Who's going to want to fly people who are sick? These are some of the things that keep doctors up at night. One last question, then I'll let you go. Yeah, but, you know, 80-something thousand of those are in China where we're not getting good data, good reports, you know. Now that we're starting to see people here, we might have better descriptions of what's going on with the disease, but, you know, it's not unusual to not know. I mean, it's all happened in a matter of weeks. I mean, I was in Atlanta in the beginning of January, and this was just coming out, and the feeling was that China was getting it under control. It wasn't going to be a big deal. We won't have to start screening flights. My friend who deals with this was on the phone with Azar and this stuff, so I just happened to be, you know, listening in, and not while they were on the phone, but afterwards. And then it didn't go like that. So, yeah, thank you.
Good night, everybody. Remember, the new Jackson Hole.